Part of the program tonight is an update on the pre-shore team color project. And David was here last year to talk about it, and here he is again with some news and discussion of what he's discovered. David Steinberg.
I began digitizing or blitzing these puzzles, working backwards in time, and in June 2012, created the Pre-Shortsian Puzzle Project and website to recruit volunteers to help. Since then, more than 40 volunteers from around the world have joined the effort, and more than 15,400 of the 16,225 Pre-Shortsian puzzles have been digitized, so the end is in sight. At this point, all the pre-Shortsian puzzles from 1978 through 1993 have been listed and proofread or up on Exword Info, and we're now digitizing puzzles from 1948. For me, one of the most interesting things about this process has been discovering just how amazing some of the pre-Shortsian puzzles were. Last year, I mentioned a brilliant puzzle entitled Every Which Way that was constructed by Dorothy E. Schiff that I brought for everyone to solve. There was a mix-up, though, so that didn't end up happening. But I posted the puzzle on Scribd, and I just checked the other day and saw that more than 500 people had viewed it and probably tried to solve it. This year, I have a new pre-Shortsian puzzle gem by Will Wang, titled Low Frequency. It was edited by Margaret Ferrer and originally published on September 6, 1964. And I hope you enjoy its unusual twist. And that puzzle in the flyer is on the two tables with pencil sharpeners in the back. So you can go pick that up at your leisure. So over the past year, we made another big discovery. In January, I received an email from Blitzer Howard Barkin, who's in this room, I think. Howard had read an article in which legendary constructor and now centenarian Bernice Gordon had said she had a vague memory of her first New York Times crossword containing the entry Mamie Eisenhower. Howard had just looked at that puzzle, which appeared on February 19, 1953, and wondered whether that puzzle was her first. Although the Pre-Shortsian Puzzle Project's database is not complete, the earliest puzzle I have on record for Bernice was indeed published on that date. So I sent Bernice PDFs of the puzzle and the solution, and she confirmed that that was the first puzzle she published in the Times. So that was a really gratifying discovery, and thanks so much again, Howard. And this past year, the project's value outside the crossword community was nationally recognized by the Davidson Institute for Talent Development with a $25,000 award, which is a great honor. As we've been working our way through the other puzzles in the Ferrer era, I've noticed that many of the Sunday constructions in particular had more complex themes than I'd anticipated. Although most of the Ferrer daily puzzles I've seen have been themelesses with more than 72 words, the contemporary maximum word count, I've also encountered puzzles with highly sophisticated themes and or word counts in the low 60s. The most interesting thing for me about the Ferrer puzzles for me, though, has definitely been the clues, which frequently included facts or sentiments about current events from when they were published. For example, Doug Peterson lists the World War II era puzzle with the clue recent gifts to Japan, and the answer was bombs. Some Ferrer puzzle clues were also amusing and thought-provoking, such as the clue, obvious answer to traffic problems. The answer was magic carpet. These discoveries and others related to the pre-Shortzian puzzles have been fascinating. I'm sure many more will surface over time. On the other front, this year, for my science research course, I've been working on statistically analyzing the differences in the numbers of puzzles published by male and female constructors over the years, an analysis that involves both pre-Shortzian and Shortzera data. The decline in the number of puzzles published by female constructors in the past two decades in the New York Times and other major crossword markets has already been noted by others and attributed to stylistic editorial bias or gender bias on the parts of today's mostly male editors. But when we look at the numbers of puzzles published by female constructors over time, we see that the story is more complicated. In the Times, for instance, over more than 70 years, all four crossword editors, Margaret Fair, Will Wang, Eugene T. Maleska, and Will Shortz, have published far fewer puzzles by female constructors than by males. And Fair, the first and only female Times crossword editor, published significantly fewer puzzles by female constructors than did Wang or Maleska. In the 20-plus years of the Shortz era, from November 1993 to present, the proportion of puzzles published by female constructors has declined relative to the Maleska and Wang eras. What makes this decline particularly interesting is that it has continued. More puzzles by female constructors are published in the earlier years of the Shortz era than in the later years. So what might be the reason for this decline? My hypothesis going into the study was that the advent of construction software could help explain the decline in the proportion of puzzles published by female constructors. The hypothesis basically grew out of the numerous studies showing that females are far less likely than males to enter computer and other technology-related fields. This gender difference begins early and persists, resulting in relatively few women in the higher echelons in technology fields. Testing this hypothesis was challenging because it required determining when construction software became mainstream enough to have an effect. After soliciting estimates on Crucifer, Bell, and elsewhere, I decided to test two pre-software time periods within the Shortz era. The first, the early estimate for the beginning of Will's editorship, November 21, 1993, through 1999, and the second, the late estimate for the first half of Will Shortz's editorship, November 21, 1993, through November 20, 2003. In each time period, I ran tests with the daily and Sunday puzzles, as well as with just the Sunday puzzles. In the first, early estimate tests, there was no statistically significant difference in the proportion of daily and Sunday puzzles published by female constructors in the pre-software period than later on. But there were significantly fewer Sunday puzzles published by female constructors in that in the later period. And in the second, late estimate tests, which divided the 20 years of Will's editorship into two equal halves, the proportions of both the daily and Sunday and the Sunday-only puzzles published by female constructors were significantly higher in the pre-software period than in the post-software period. These findings support the hypothesis that the increasingly widespread use of construction software might indeed help to explain the decline in the proportion of puzzles published by female constructors. If we look at the history of crossword construction, before software was available, all constructors, male and female, built their puzzles by hand. Although there were still proportionally more puzzles published by male constructors and by female constructors, the gender disparity was not as pronounced as what we see today. My theory is that when crossword construction software really began to take off, women, with some exceptions, were left behind. It wasn't that they couldn't master the software. Clearly they could, and every bit as well as their male counterparts. But as a group, female constructors may not have embraced it in the way that more technologically oriented males did. I think construction software also changed the puzzles themselves, giving rise, over time, to more complex constructions. The more skilled the constructor is with the software, the more he or she can manipulate the software to create complex constructions. And since the software dramatically speeds up the construction process, I'm guessing that constructors who are exceptionally adept with it also tend to produce and to submit many more puzzles, increasing the odds of an acceptance. So the software has changed three things: who tends to use it most, whose puzzles are most complex, and who submits the most puzzles. and the rise of computer-assisted crossword instruction, together with today's much more rigid standards for FIL, means that crossword construction has become less of a literary exercise it used to be, and more of a mathematical exercise. This shift helps to explain the decline in the proportion of puzzles published by female constructors over the past two decades. And I expect that as the gender disparity in tech fields diminishes, the gender disparity among crossword constructors will also drop. I'm planning to conduct more statistical tests on these data next year, and I'm looking forward to seeing whether there are any other interesting patterns in the puzzles over time. So that's some of what's been happening with the pre-shortsy and puzzle project since last March. If any of you would like to help out with the project, just let me know. The listing is almost complete, so we especially need experienced, highly accurate proofreaders, though new listeners are always welcome. Thanks for listening, and I hope you all enjoy the pre-shortsy and puzzles.